early 1920s, one invention would signal the start of the modern era and the dissemination of information around the world. For the first time, the events of history could be reported as they happened to almost anywhere on Earth. While this invention had been around since just past the turn of the century, it was during the Roaring Twenties that it began to change the world. That historic invention was radio. Welcome, fellow YouTubers. The Roaring Twenties radio channel brings you another video on early radio. I would greatly appreciate it if you would hit the subscribe button if you're not a subscriber already. On Christmas Eve in 1906, Canadian inventor Reginald Fessenden was the first person to broadcast voice and music over radio waves. Fessenden had come up with a formula to radically change radio from transmitting information using the dots and dashes of Morse code to transmitting voice and music over those same radio waves. You could say it was Reginald Fessenden's Christmas gift to the world, although for the most part, his gift really wouldn't be appreciated until 15 years later, when broadcast radio exploded around the world. The beginning of the 1920s would be the start of huge changes in the lives of the American public. Electricity started finding its way to homes back in 1882, but only 10% of homes had electricity in 1910, mostly the rich. By 1920, 35% of homes had electric power, and by the end of the decade, over two-thirds of the public was enjoying the benefits of electricity. It was during the 1920s that automobiles began to take over the roadways. In 1919, there were 6.7 million cars on the road. But by the end of the 1920s, there was 27 million cars on the road, one for almost every home. The first concrete paved road was Woodward Avenue in Detroit in 1909. At the start of the 20s, there were 12,000 gas stations, and by the end of the decade, there was 143,000. The 1920s were the beginning of the modern era. The country was changing from agrarian to an industrial economy. Change was coming at an ever-increasing pace. Automation was changing the way things were built, and new inventions were changing the way the average Americans lived. Of all the changes and new inventions in the 1920s, which one would change the world more than any other? The argument could be made that one thing that would impact lives more than any other was the availability of radio to the general public. Radio arrived in many homes long before electricity. The simple early crystal sets of the late teens and the very beginning of the 20s would quickly give way to battery-powered radios and the explosion of radio stations that followed. The first true mass medium had arrived. Radio connected America during the most turbulent decade in its history. Radio was able to connect the home to the rest of the world in real time, no matter where that home was located. From homes in the cities to farms in remote rural areas, whether poor or rich, radio connected the country to what was happening, as it happened around the world. There had been nothing like it before. Radio raged like a prairie fire over the country. Sales of radio skyrocketed and radio stations sprung up from coast to coast, sweeping from east to west. In 1921, there were just 5 licensed radio stations in the entire country. 2 years later, there were 400. By the end of the decade, there would be over 600 radio stations. On August 20, 1920, the first federally licensed radio station to offer a full lineup of regularly scheduled programming went on the air in Detroit. Station 8MK. Station 8MK's first transmitter had a range of about 100 miles. The station would broadcast the first news program and election results on August 31st, just 11 days after its first broadcast. It's estimated that the total audience for the broadcast was about 200 homes with crystal sets. Over a century later, that same station is still around and has grown into a 50,000-watt superstation, operating under the call sign WWJ. Radio stations would regularly upgrade their transmitters to reach more and more listeners. The range of programming increased and stations began tailoring their programming to what local listeners wanted to hear. In rural areas, weather reports and farm reports would give farmers current information for the first time. Crop yields and per bushel prices let farmers know what prices they could expect for all of their hard work. In urban areas, stock prices and business news would keep listeners glued to their radios. opera and big bands fronted by soloists filled the airwaves. At first, music recordings on heavily shellacked records provided the music on radio. Later, live performances filled the airwaves. Religious programs were popular all over the country. Family life was changed forever as radio drew families away from other ways of entertainment, like reading and playing games. Families began gathering around the radio in the morning to listen to news and weather reports, and again at night to hear their favorite music and entertainment shows. To the people of the 1920s, it was a magical experience to be able to hear someone speak from a place that was hundreds of miles away. For many people, radio would be the first time they would hear an orchestra play or an opera singer sing. Voices and music coming out of thin air, or ether as it was often called back then. Radio was such a shock to some that they claimed it was the work of the devil and railed against it. Others claimed it was a trick of some kind.
Why are you so against getting a wireless?
In a way, I wish you'd just say it. Cousin Robert, please buy a wireless for Downton.
I wouldn't mind.
That's because you're American, but I'm not, and I find the whole idea a kind of thief of life. That people should waste hours huddled around a wooden box listening to someone talking at them, burbling inanities from somewhere else.
But surely now with the latest news and everything, and it must be a boon for the old. What do you think, Bates?
I can't see the dowager with a wireless, lady.
It's a fad. It won't last.
But those voices faded away as radio grew more popular at an astounding rate. With radio becoming all the rage around the country, every business wanted to be associated with one way or another. Businesses you wouldn't imagine having anything to do with radio wanted their customers to know they were part of this great leap into the modern era. A dairy company changed its name to the Radio Milk Company. I confess, the connection between milk and radio escapes me at the moment. Casket companies began selling radios. Perhaps they thought a nice crystal set in the departed's casket would provide some soothing music on their trip to heaven, or in some cases, to a warmer climate. There were radio brand cigarettes, radio brand cigars, radio brand steel needles used to play records and Victrolas, radio pencils, and many more peculiar pairings. All over the country, new radio manufacturing companies sprouted and were quickly followed by newborn radio tube companies. Accurate records from the 1920s are scarce, but you could safely guess that the number of companies spawned by radio was over 1,000 and possibly many more than that. As the number of radio manufacturers grew, so did the radio parts business. Companies that built parts like coils, transformers, tube sockets, condensers, and rheostats sprung up, driven by both young entrepreneurs and well-established manufacturers. Automobile parts manufacturers were especially well-suited to dive into radio and radio parts manufacturing. In fact, one of the established automobile parts manufacturing companies that took the plunge into radio manufacturing became the most successful. That company had the good fortune of having a visionary who knew what the public would want to buy before most of the public was buying it. He saw the explosive growth of automobiles while their sales were still relatively meager. Still, he knew they were the future and started an auto parts company. When he heard about radio, he learned all that he could about it and decided that it would be the next big thing to catch fire with consumers. He made the decision to start building radio parts and soon after began building and selling complete radios. The radio business boomed and his company went along for the ride. Right to the top of the radio business. The visionary's name was Arthur Atwater Kent. Arthur preferred using his middle name and named his company accordingly. The Atwater Kent Radio Company became the largest radio manufacturer of the 1920s. Although Atwater Kent had the largest slice of the radio sales pie, there was plenty of bias for other radio companies to thrive alongside the leader in radio sales, at least for a limited time. Many of the companies that tried to carve out their own place in radio failed rather quickly, doomed by bad management, lack of funds, poor radio design, and not knowing what the customer wanted led to a large percentage of startups to fail in a few years, or in some cases, a few months. Early on, radio stations were self-funded. This was not a business model for long-term success. Equipping and operating a decent radio station was not cheap. The solution to radio's funding problem was advertising, now known as radio commercials. Small local radio stations would run commercials for local businesses, and they were a success. As more and more people learned of a business, More customers came through the doors, and the improvement in sales showed up at the cash register. The first radio commercial was broadcast in San Jose, California, way back in 1912 on radio station FN. The man who built and owned the station was Charles Harold. Most people knew him, just called him Doc. Now that radio stations had a way of funding and hopefully turning a profit, the last piece of the puzzle needed for the long-term success of radio was in place. In 1927, radio manufacturers came out with electric radios. This would be great news for the 58% or so of homes that had electricity at the time. Instead of having to use several batteries to play the radios, all they had to do was plug it in. Since many homes with electricity were only wired for lighting, an adapter was used to plug the radio into a light socket. That same year, radio station KGFJ in Los Angeles became the first radio station to broadcast 24 hours a day, giving night owls something to listen to for the first time. Possibly one of the biggest advances in the acceptance of radio was single-dial tuning. Instead of having to adjust and readjust several knobs and dials to tune in a radio station, listeners would only have to adjust one dial, making tuning in a radio station much quicker and less frustrating for many users. What a difference going from this to this. One major advance in radio reception was the super heterodyne circuit. The new radio reception circuit brought in radio stations much clearer and greatly improving the sound of AM radio. It's generally thought that inventor Edwin H. Armstrong invented the super heterodyne radio circuit, but that belief may not be true, and we will cover that subject in another video. No matter who invented it, Super Heterodyne was a great advance in radio, and the first company to bring the new technology to the public was the Victor Talking Machine Company of Camden, New Jersey, in 1924. The radio was designated the AR-812 and was an instant hit with radio listeners. Its strong, clear sound was amazing compared to previous radios. It's been over a century since the general public has enjoyed listening to radio. And over that time, there's been many changes and improvements. Radio's program has changed over time with listeners' tastes. Opera gave way to jazz, and then listeners' preferences changed to crooners like Frank Sinatra and Perry Como. In the mid-1950s, a young man named Elvis Presley brought rock and roll to radio. While groups from England like the Beatles took over the airwaves in the mid-1960s. In the sports world, radio became home to broadcasts of baseball and other sporting events, while the news remains a staple of broadcasting today with all new superstations informing listeners of the latest news and current events, often broadcasting them live as they happen. The invention of television would lead to the decline of radio. Beginning in the 1950s, when consumers began buying television sets in large numbers, more and more of the public started dividing their time between radio and television, and eventually television pushed radio aside as the most popular form of news and entertainment in the home. Some prognosticators predict the end of radio is coming, but with over 4,700 radio stations in the U.S. alone and 82 million listeners, that day is a long way off, if it ever comes. Most people are unaware of the fact that some of today's most important technology would not be possible without radio. Cell phones, Bluetooth, satellite cable TV, and others are all based on the principles of early radio. All of these ways of modern communication are based on technology that can be traced back to the 18th century. When America landed astronauts on the moon in 1969, they were able to communicate with them by radio. Today, NASA still communicates with the Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 space probes by radio transmission. Those satellites are 12 and 15 billion miles from Earth. Even today's satellite communication is achieved using radio waves. We owe a great debt to the men who envisioned the future back in the late 18th and early 19th century. Their commitment to an idea that most of the people of their time didn't believe in is the testament to the strength of their beliefs and their character. Guillermo Marconi, Reginald Fessenden, Lee DeForest, Edwin Armstrong, Thomas Edison, Frank Conrad, John Fleming, Maurice Levy, James Maxwell, Heinrich Hertz, Ernest Anderson, and several others gave us the gift of the first true mass medium, radio. That's it for this video. There will be more to come as we continue to investigate the early history of the world's first true mass medium, radio. Thanks for watching.